God promises that your dreams really can come true. Do you have your little piece of paper to take some notes on again? I want to give you some things to practice on Monday morning. And if you don't write them down, I guarantee you, you won't remember a thing I said tomorrow. So go ahead and write them down, and tomorrow you'll walk a little closer with Jesus, and your life will be a whole lot better. God promises that your dreams really can come true. In the Bible, there are basically two types of dreams. The first type of dream is a revelation from God, like the dreams that God revealed to Joseph in Egypt about the future. And those kind of dreams always come true. Now, we don't have those kind of dreams today because we have the complete revealed Word of God, and the very last page of the Bible says don't add to it. But the Bible talks about a second kind of dream, and that's our imagination. That's our dreams, our goals, the things that we would like to see accomplished in the future. And those kind of dreams can come true. Well, tonight I want to focus on the second kind of dream, our imagination. Now, I know that there's all kinds of people in the world, but for me, I'm a very simple person, and I think there's really only two kinds of people in the world. There are dreamers, and there are workers. There are dreamers, those who imagine the future, and you've seen them in a high school classroom. They're sort of staring out the window. Teacher has to call their attention. God loves those kind of people. We need them. In our marriage, in our congregation, in our business. And then there's the workers, those that grab someone's dream and try to make it happen. My wife here is a dreamer. She's been dreaming about all kinds of things since she was about 4 years old. When she was 15 years old, she took out a piece of paper and she made a list of her dream husband. She began praying to God about her dream husband. About 6 years later, we are married. And I find this list as I rummage through her things. And there I am on the piece of paper. God answered her prayers, realized her dream in every detail. Well, I used to have hair. You know, I don't know if she got a very good deal, but she got what she asked for. And my wife's been dreaming since she was just a little girl about being a foreign missionary. Since she was just a little girl, she said, I'm going to have three kids. They're all going to go through college. I'm going to own my own house one day. Well, when we got together, we started dating and getting a little serious and thinking about getting married. She shared with me her dreams. Three kids? Scared me to death. A foreign country? Can't we just live right here? Own our own home? Oh, we don't have any money. That'll never happen. You know, when she met me, I'm not a dreamer. I'm a worker. And I'm such a worker. I am so focused on today, I can't see past tomorrow. And if it wasn't for other people's dreams, I would probably be like the Energizer Bunny, just going around beating my drum with not much to show for it. How about you? Are you a worker or are you a dreamer? Now, if you are a worker, are you seeing great things happen around you? Or are you a little frustrated because of a lot of activity and little productivity? Maybe you've gotten up in the morning, 5:30 in the morning for years. You've poured coffee through your system. You've raced off to the daily grind. And you woke up years later with little to show for your efforts, and you're frustrated. Are you a dreamer? Have your dreams come true? Or are you a little frustrated with the lack of success and all that your imagination comes up with? Maybe when you were younger, you dreamed of a successful career. Maybe you dreamed of a happy marriage, among other things. But your dreams haven't come true. Is there any hope for a frustrated dreamer or a frustrated worker? Well, the Bible talks about those who imagine the future, and God promises that your dreams really can come true. What's involved in having a dream come true? Let's write down the first thing we're going to practice this afternoon, or maybe tomorrow morning. What's the first thing we need to do? We need to imagine a great dream. Let's write it down, because if you don't write it down, you're going to forget. Imagine a great dream. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 says this. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. The Bible says that God can accomplish our dreams far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think. But for something to be accomplished, we must think. We must use our imagination. We need to think about something so great, so amazing, so beyond human capacity. Nothing will happen until someone dreams and imagines the future. Now, for the dreamer, that's real easy. But for the worker, you need to hang out with someone with a great dream like I did. What's involved in having a dream come true? Number two, you need to involve God in your dream. You need to involve God in your dream. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 3 says this. Commit your work, to the Lord, and your plans will be established. Verse 9. The heart of a man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. The Bible promises that your dreams really can come true if you will involve God in your dream. Many dreamers imagine things so incredibly beyond the capacity of any human, beyond the strength of any worker. But we don't have to worry about that because God has all the power and all the resources we need. Ephesians chapter 3 said, now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think. Yeah, he provides. And in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, when the Apostle Paul is scratching out a thank you note to the Philippian church, telling them thank you for being his partners in the gospel and for providing finances for his ministry, he ends the book of Philippians and he says, my God will supply all of your needs in Christ Jesus. He has all the resources, all the power that we need. If you want to see your dreams come true, involve God in your dreams. Number three, what's involved in having a dream come true? Investigate God's will for your dream. Investigate God's will for your dream. 1 John chapter 5 is amazing. Verse 14 and 15. And this is the confidence that we have towards him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests we have asked of him. Now, do you pray like that? God promises that our dreams really can come true. God says in the Bible that he will help our dreams come true if they don't contradict his will. You know what? A good father is not going to give something or do something for his child that might hurt them. Dad can have a 45. I don't think so. It's not appropriate right now. But you know, what is God's will? What is God's will? God's will has to do with the development of three relationships. God loves to help dreams come true that have something to do with a relationship with him, a relationship with one another, or the relationship with your neighbor that doesn't know Jesus anymore. If your dreams have anything to do with living for God, loving one another, or sending the light to that lost person, I can guarantee you God will make your dreams come true, and he will do it in a way that's far beyond anything you can imagine and beyond any human capacity and power. Psalms 37, verse 4 says, delight yourselves in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Other translations say, trust in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Imagine what would happen in our relationship with God. Imagine what would happen in a dating relationship. What would happen in your marriage? What would happen in your family? What would happen in your business? What would happen in this congregation? If each and every one of us wrote down this outline, and we imagined a great dream, and we began praying about it, and we investigated God's will for it, I tell you, fantastic dreams would happen in the lives of everyone in this congregation. Tonight I want to share with you the greatest dream of all time. God's dream. God had a dream to have an eternal family. And He created mankind. And mankind sinned. And He separated from the eternal Father. But did God give up on His dream? No, God became a man and walked to a cross. Jesus came here to continue the dream. Jesus came to pursue the lost, prepare fishermen to reach out to the lost, to bring people back into the family, and He provided His death on a cross to reconcile us back into that eternal family. And when He completed His mission, He took this mission and He delegated it to the apostles. And the apostles had a mandate, go. And they had a message, the gospel. They had a method, grow disciples, and they had a motivation. God will always be with you. And as they carried out their message, the New Testament church began in Acts chapter 2. And they taught these new disciples about the mission of God. And this new congregation, as it spread around the world, exalted the Master for their salvation. This new congregation evangelized the spiritual morgue around their house. They edified the members and they equipped missionaries. And I finally arrived in the 20th century when this mission, this dream was planted in my heart. I was sitting at the Bear Valley School of Biblical Studies. I was 17 years old, and I heard about the four billion lost souls out in the world. And a missionary came to Bear Valley from Brazil, and he shared his dream about the lost masses in Brazil, 190 million people. And his dream was to plant a church in every capital city in the nation. That was 30 years ago. Today, there's a church of our Lord in every state capital. Well, in 1982, I was 18 years old, and I'm hearing about this great dream to reach cities that have no church of our Lord. An interest group was formed at Bear Valley in 1982, and I want to introduce to you the people that heard this dream. Over on the far side is Rod Neely and his wife, Linda. He was a Palmida store manager, and someone called him to be a preacher. After graduating, he preached up in Gillette, Wyoming for a while. Next to him is John and Sharina Langley. Now, John Langley was a plumber for the railroad around the Cheyenne, Laramie, Wyoming area. Next to him, you hardly recognize him because he used to have hair. That's me and my wife when I was about 19 years old. And I was a vacuum cleaner repairman and carpet cleaner from Jackson Hole, Wyoming. My dad taught me four professions before I graduated from high school and said, why go to college? Well, Dad, I've got a dream. I've got to go tell people. And so I abandoned my four professions and I went to school. And next to me is Ron and Georgia Freitas. They're from the Taft, California area, and he was an oil field worker. God brought us together for a great dream. The dream was to form the Curitiba evangelistic team. Our goal was to go to the city of Curitiba. It's a city of 3 million people. And we began imagining what could be accomplished by a few guys from Wyoming and one guy from California. What can be accomplished? John Langley and I were in the same class at Bear Valley. And in 1984, the two of us got together in the evening, about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and we worked for 11 straight hours through the night until 6 o'clock in the morning. Now, John is a dreamer, and I'm a worker. He can't hardly write down a paragraph, but boy, he can think big. I can't think big, but boy, I can write down a paragraph. For 11 straight hours, John dreamed. And he said, Alan, I can imagine a gigantic church in the heart of Curitiba. I can see this church with its own elders and deacons and evangelists, a self-sustaining church. And I got out this big 25-foot-long butcher paper. and I put a flow chart on it. And I started to write down every detail, every resource needed, every breath we're going to take for the next 10 years. And we went and ate pancakes after 11 hours of dreaming. The plan was real simple. Let me show you my butcher paper in the most simple format possible. Our butcher paper started out with the Curitiba evangelistic team. And our plan was to move to Curitiba, learn the Portuguese language, learn the Brazilian culture, exalt the master in that language, evangelize the spiritual morgue around our houses, edify these new members, and equip missionaries. Our goal was to work ourselves out of a job. And this would happen through a transition stage where we would teach this brand new church to exalt the master, evangelize the spiritual morgue around their house, edify the new members, and equip missionaries. As one by one, the American missionary team would back out. There would no longer be an evangelistic American team, but there would be a Brazilian church team taking the word to the next generation. When we finished that 25-foot butcher paper with all of our dreams and goals on it, I was 19 years old. And God made our dreams come true. Today, in the heart of that city, there is a congregation of 290 active, not just 290 on the rolls, 290 active members, an army of God, with about 60 children, 350 people, that are a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching, Bible-living church. I want to just let you experience worship, how it was in Curitiba today. King of the universe, I give you my worship. You have surrounded my life with blessings. You are the source of all my joy, the fountain of my joy. My whole life is dedicated, my pleasure is to know you. You are the owner of my heart. And there is no other.
Só tu és o dono do meu coração. Só tu és o dono do meu coração.
And they keep on singing, they're beautiful people. Why is the Curitiba church growing so much? Well, in the beginning, we didn't have a facility to meet in. So we rented the high school building for 4 hours, and we didn't have a place to meet midweek. And so we just started meeting in our homes. Well, we had 15 baptisms in 5 months, meeting in a small group. So we thought, hey, this works. So after we finally grew and we actually had a facility we could meet in, we just kept using our homes because it's so cool for evangelism. It's team evangelism in your home. And so we use small groups. This is actually our living room, Rhea and my living room, on a Tuesday evening at 7:30. And as you look around the room, you'll see 4 new converts just in the past 2 years. You'll see 3 visitors. And that young couple that's sitting on the couch, they're brand new Christians, about 2 years old. And they're leading the small group in my house this week while we're here. Our home's open to the public even though we're not there. And they're continuing to evangelize the neighbors, the spiritual morgue around my house. There's always children that show up to our small groups. And so my wife or my daughter, they separate the small children into another room and give them Bible class. And my wife's already raised one generation that is now Christians. And she's starting a second generation in our small group on Tuesdays. This is Sunday morning worship, or Sunday morning Bible class in Curitiba. We have a men's class in the auditorium. We have a women's class in the fellowship room. We have a youth class, college class upstairs. We have a couples class upstairs. We have 5 children's classes spread around the building. It's a lot like being here with you today, but they speak Portuguese. It's amazing what God's doing. I think I've lost my power. There we are. I'm just going to go a little faster. This is a special day in Curitiba that we do once a year. It's called the 3-in-1 Congress. It's actually 3 conferences that we do in 1 weekend. We'll have about 36 classes we offer over the weekend. And we talk about small group evangelism, marriage and family, church growth, spiritual growth. This year and last year, we've added a new element, how to develop elders and deacons in your congregation. We call people all over the nation of Brazil to come spend a weekend with us. And it's our way to encourage our local congregation and for our congregation to encourage them. And now other congregations around the nation of Brazil are imitating the model in Curitiba. In fact, the church in Portugal wrote about 3 years ago and said, can we have your material for small groups and for spiritual growth process? And so we're even into Europe with the material that we produced in Curitiba. I'm going to shorten this a little bit. This is one of the most historic days in the day of the church in Curitiba. This is March 27th, 2011, when Rod Nalley, one of the American missionaries, along with myself and our Brazilian evangelist, Mauro Francisco, the three of us laid our hands on three elderly men that assumed the role of shepherd in the congregation. We didn't cure anybody. We didn't transmit any miraculous gifts. There's a third type of laying hands in the scripture, and that is Acts chapter 13, when they laid their hands on Paul and Barnabas, and they sent them out as missionaries. Well, this was our laying on of hands to ask God's blessing on their new ministry. José Carlos Sotomayor, Vilmar Buchel, Luis Silva. He works in a factory. He's an auto mechanic. José Carlos, when we met him, he was sleeping on the floor of a factory where he worked. He lived a very evil lifestyle. And it's just amazing to see how God has changed his life. I baptized him in 1991. I watched him as he got married. I watched him as he grew his children, raised his children in the Lord for 21 years. I saw that he had the gift of shepherd a year or two before he was ever designated to be one of the shepherds. Wonderful man. He was sleeping on a factory floor. Today he has an international business. Phenomenal man. At the end of our worship services, at our invitation time, we really don't offer a gospel invitation because we do that 7 days a week, and we have baptisms any night of the week. But we offer time for prayer at the end of our worship services, and the three elders come up front, and people with any needs, instead of taking the time to announce them to all the church, these people just come up and whisper their prayer need into the elder's ear, and he prays for them right now. And they're just constant simultaneous prayers at the end of our worship services. This is José Carlos, one of our elders, giving us an encouraging message before I came up here. On that same day, March 27, 2011, Rod Nalley and myself, we laid our hands on three Brazilian evangelists. We have Cicero Balbino, Mauro Francisco, and Ramos Costa. The first two men here are fully supported by the Curitiba congregation. No American money to support these two guys, and they're doing a great job. We didn't have enough money to support the third guy, but he works a secular job, and every week he teaches Bible class, he preaches, he teaches one-on-one Bible studies, he leads a small group. He works like a full-time evangelist, but at the moment he's supporting himself. Within the year, the congregation is already making plans to support a third evangelist, so we'll have four evangelists, Lord willing. On this same day, the three elders, along with the three evangelists at that time, we laid our hands on six Brazilian deacons. Davi Pena, Gilberto Castaneda, Mauricio Beni, Pedro Jori, Fernando Dias, and Marcos Siqueira. They do a phenomenal job. These guys take care of all the busy work. They make all the decisions about finances and carpet and paint and electric and maintenance or whatever. And the shepherds take care of souls, and the evangelists just evangelize. It's the coolest thing that the model God gave us in His Word. There is no longer an American missionary team in Curitiba. All the families have pulled out, went back to the United States, with the exception of our family. And we haven't been in the Curitiba leadership for about 2 years now. And God gave us a brand new dream in Brazil. And we're so thankful that you're a part of it. But this is the new Brazil team that's taking the Word of God to the next generation. 12 men and their wives, and they're doing a great job. Now that concluded my 25-foot butcher paper dreams and goals. John Langley dreaming and I'm writing it down. But God always does beyond, abundantly beyond, whatever we ask or think. We never dreamed that God would give us a building. Our dream was to rent and grow and rent and grow. And God made it real clear through some wise men that unless you put down some roots, buy your home, and build some type of facility, the Brazilians will never take you serious. They treated us like a fly-by-night organization. But when we built a building, the Brazilians said, these guys are here to stay. They're here to invest in our grandchildren. Well, that's when the church started growing. How did we get this wonderful facility? A lot of American churches helped us. But you know what? The American churches wouldn't do anything till the Brazilians stepped up to the plate. And do you know what this congregation did? When we were 50 members strong, this congregation said, we will give $100,000 over a four-year period. Now that's from people that earn $400 a month, $800 a month, $1,000 a month. Some make $15,000, some make $2,000 a month. Very little. You know how much they gave? $160,000 over a 10-year period. And because of their commitment, their generosity, they're turning off the TV, cable TV, turning down the heat, not going to the mall, put Jesus first. They gave $160,000 and it left the Americans with their mouth open. And a church in Oklahoma says, we'll give $100,000. A church in Texas said, we'll give $100,000. Another church said, we'll give $100,000. And we have a complete building that sets up to 1,000 people, totally paid for. Glory to God. God always does beyond what we ask or think. God also helped us in 2005 to begin a full-time, two-year, 40-course preacher training school in Curitiba. And it was a full-time school for 5 years, and we had three graduating classes. And as you look around the photos, you'll see one of our elders graduated from there. Two of our evangelists graduated from there. You'll see Mel Jr. there in the back. Great work. We love Mel and Becky to death, and I wish they were still in Curitiba. But God knows their needs, and they're working their plan of life right now. And maybe one day they'll come back to Brazil, Lord willing. But our school is now just a part-time school because three of our faculty members moved away. That left two of us. One guy's overwhelmed in all the evangelism he's doing. That left me. So our school right now is a part-time school on Monday evenings. And I teach anywhere from 20 to 40 local members on a Monday evening for 3 hours. They come out to learn Greek with me. They come out to learn the book of Revelation. And I'm taking them through the preacher training school, but it's a real slow process. God has also done in my life far beyond anything I could ever imagine. Since our preacher training school is now a part-time school with dreams of being a full-time school again, for now, there are some other preacher training schools in the nation that have full-time students, but they don't have lots of teachers. And so they started calling and asking for help, and they called me. For the past 2 years, this right here is the Campo Grande congregation. Well, it's actually not the congregation, it's their preacher training school. They're out on the western frontier near Bolivia, and they called and they said, can you help us as a teacher for our 10 full-time students? And so I show up there twice a year, and I teach from Tuesday till Friday, and I give them 24 hours of Bible instruction. It's sort of like preaching 52 sermons in a week, if you can imagine that. There's another preaching school just north of us, about a six-hour drive, in the city of Campinas, São Paulo. And they have 20 full-time students. And they not only call me, they also call our sister's annual senior. They call him, too, as a teacher. We're both there at all these different places. And I'm always trying to remember Vanellas, not Vanellas, Vanilda, got it. They call her brother to teach too, but I go to Campinas twice a year, and from Monday through Saturday, I give them 27 hours of Bible instruction. Last year in 2009, I gave over 450 lessons in about a 2.5 month period. Can you imagine preaching that much time in 2.5 months? I did these 9 intensive studies. They're overwhelming, and that's why I'm such a skinny guy, because I burn up a lot of calories. Last year, they also called Ree and I to the Northeast, and they called together church leaders from over 100 congregations in the Northeast to help me teach them how to do small group ministry or how to perfect their small group ministry. While I was there in the cities of Recife and Fortaleza, they had my wife go there. My wife worked with the women while I worked with the guys. They had about 100 church leaders there. And they wanted to know, how do you train elders and deacons from scratch? How do you take a brand new convert and he becomes a shepherd or a deacon of the Lord's church? And so I did that last year. And I'm beginning to be a coach all over the nation for this type of activity. God also did above and beyond anything that we could imagine, because the Curitiba congregation is now planted 2 brand new congregations. In 2007, the Sitio Cercado congregation began. We took our our preacher training school graduates, and we gave them experience in church planting. They began with about 20 people, and now they have about 80 in attendance. The downtown congregation in Curitiba pays the rent on this facility. It sets about 100 people, costs $600 a month. I can't believe they've been paying $600 a month since 2007. I think they could have paid for their own facility by now. But we need to help them dream and organize so they can have their own facility one day, because they're already at capacity in their building. The downtown congregation also supports Cicero Balbino, who's a full-time worker in this congregation. When I arrived back from my last trip, I got to Curitiba in 2010, and we found out that an elderly sister from the congregation, she's in her 70s, and her single son is in his 40s, and they have two adopted kids. They decided to move the interior of the state of Paraná. It's about a 3.5-hour drive from our house. They moved to a city of 200,000 people, and there's no church. What do you think this elderly lady is going to do with her son? They began to take the Lord's Supper every Sunday in their home for a few weeks. And then they called me on the phone. They said, "Can you help us? Do you have any free time?" So my wife and I agreed with them that we would go there every 30 to 40 days to help them out. And over the past 2 years, we've made about 10 trips there. We'll spend about 4 days with them over a weekend, and I'll give them 10 hours of Bible instruction. I was able to teach eight people that have been baptized in the last 2 years. And to see this church grow, it now meets in this little home on the corner. This is a bricklayer's home. He works so hard to support his family that he can't even have time to finish his own house. This is his living room, and about 20 people are packed in there on a Sunday to worship God. Three of these guys are brand new converts. They've only been Christians for about a year and a half. And they rotate the preaching every Sunday. Can you imagine just being baptized a year and a half and you're already preaching every other Sunday? One of these guys up here in the top, he already set up 6 Bible studies in the last 3 months. I believe there's been a couple baptized last week, or they're going to be baptized this week. Because of the Bible study he set up. He's a brand new Christian. This guy down here at the bottom is young. He really blows me away. He's 15 years old. Brand new Christian. He goes to high school during the day. He takes a computer class once a week. He works as a full-time waiter at night to help support his elderly grandmother. And what's he doing in his free time? He sleeps. But you know, he preaches once a month. And when I show up there in the city of Guadalupe, they always expect me to speak when I show up. And when I get there to worship, I like to joke around a lot. So I sort of rib him, say, "You ready to speak tonight or this morning?" He said, "Sure." I'm joking. He's ready. We have more men like Jian. I want to tell you just a few quick stories, and then I got to sit down. I want to tell you about what's happened in Curitiba in the last 2.5 years. We've had 75 baptisms. They're not instant evangelism. Every time we start to approach someone to set up a Bible study, it takes anywhere from 3 to 4 months to 2 years just to get a Bible study with them. Then it takes anywhere from 3 to 6 months to a year before they're baptized. They believe in God, they believe in the Bible, but they're very cautious people. And they don't want anybody taking their money. And especially the guy with a strong accent like I have in Portuguese, they're like 1 foot back. I mean, how do you say that in English? I don't know. Um pé atrás. They're very cautious people. And so, but I want to talk to you some people that it's taken us a while to bring to Jesus, but it's phenomenal what God's done in their life. This is Sara Fajeda. She's a slum girl. I don't know if you know anything about a slum girl in Brazil, but a slum girl, when they get to be about 12 years old, the parents just put them on the street for any guy to take home. Well, some guy took her home. And my wife and I got to meet this young slum couple living together, and we became their friends. And we taught them the gospel, and they repented, and they separated. He had a place to live. She had no place to go. Her mom and dad don't want her back. In fact, her mom and dad are split up, and she has nowhere to go. My wife said, "You're going to my house, young lady." She's just became a Christian, brand new baptized. My wife teaches her how to cook, teaches her how to clean, teaches her how to dress appropriately, teaches her how to be a Christian wife, how to be a Christian woman, helps meet the marriage couple. And this young couple was married, and they're the young couple leads my small group in my house while I'm up here talking to you right now. Phenomenal what God's done in this life. Let me tell you about Felipe. We met him on my daughter met him on a trip. We were up in Bauru preaching, and there was a special seminar, and some visitors showed up, and And my daughter exchanged emails with him and started talking on Skype and became friends. Well, one evening, this boy that lives 5-hour drive from Curitiba in the city of Londrina, has about 500,000 people. There is a local church there. He's talking with Skype with my daughter, and he says, "Would you like to be my girlfriend?" And my daughter says, "I only date Christians. I don't date non-Christians." Well, they get to talking about what it means to become a Christian, how to become a Christian, and he's bombarding her with questions, and she's holding her own. And all of a sudden, she just feels so overwhelmed. She said, "Hang on, would you like to talk to my dad?" And before you know it, I'm dragged into this Skype conversation. And when I start talking with this young man, Felipe, he brings in his best buddy into the conversation. He brings his sister into the conversation. And we start talking about Jesus until they're tired out. "How about next week we start again?" And next week I got on Skype again and we study the scriptures. And he said, "I'm ready to become a Christian." He gets on a bus. He comes to Curitiba. I baptize him for the forgiveness of sins. He gets back on the bus. He goes back home. His sister becomes a Christian. His best buddy becomes a Christian. They're participating in that local church in Londrina. It's great to see what God is doing. And for the last, before I come up here, for about 6 months, I helped them with follow-up studies on Skype every week. This is Christopher. Christopher became a Christian about 2 years ago. He is a drug addict. When I got to meet him, he'd just been beat to a pulp. He'd been left for dead in the street. His face was so swollen, you couldn't see his face. Someone picked him up and took him to the hospital. About a month later, I got to meet Christopher the first time. He'd been off drugs for a month. They'd taken him home. He's off drugs for another month. And I began to talk to him about Jesus and what Jesus can do for his life. He became a Christian. Now, drugs are a strong pull. So, he comes to Bible class with me on Sunday, every Sunday, for worship. On Monday, he comes to my house. I spend a little time with him. On Tuesday, he comes to my small group. On Wednesday, he comes to my house. On Thursday, I go to his house. And we spend time together just to keep him off the street as he grows and gets over that addiction. Well, I began to go to his house. When I got to his house, I noticed that the weeds in his front yard are about knee high. And I said, "Do you guys have a lawnmower?" "No, we don't have a lawnmower." I said, "I'll be over my day off on Friday, and I'll cut this grass for you." So I went over there and knocked the weeds down for him. About a month later, his mom's like, "What's going on here? Who is this guy?" About a month later, their weeds are about knee high again. I get my lawnmower out on my day off, go over there and cut their grass. Well, his mom starts having me in for coffee. I start inviting her to our small group. And then after about 4 or 5 months, I set up a one-on-one Bible study with her. About 6 months later, his mother, Licia, becomes a New Testament Christian. And she's 65 years old, still works to support her family. Wonderful woman in the faith. This is João Sampaio. When I got back in 2010, one of the brothers of the church said, "Can you go to my brother's house? He's on his deathbed. Will you pray for him?" And so we went there to pray for him. And while I'm there talking and visiting and praying, his sister-in-law shows up, Genoveva. And she came to visit her deathbed brother-in-law. And as we talked, I said a Bible study with them. And over the next couple of weeks, we're sharing the scriptures. Well, João gets better. And Genoveva is so excited about what she's learning, she says, "You need to come to my house. My daughter needs to hear about this." So now I'm going to João's house one day and I'm going to her house on Saturday. João becomes a Christian. His health gets better. He goes back to work. I help him with follow-up studies. He goes to worship with me. And then his health declines again. He's got some type of dementia right now. We need to be praying for him. But when I show up at Genoveva's house on Saturday, it wasn't just her daughter that was there. There's this whole crowd of people. She had a daughter there with her husband. She had another daughter there with her boyfriend. She had another daughter there with her live-in boyfriend. She had a niece there that was living with some guy for the last 11 years. And I walk into this whole crowd of people. And for the next 6 to 8 months, I teach them the scriptures. And I finished all of my lessons, and no one's making a decision. So I say, "Well, come to church on Sunday. Find out who we are." And I just walked away. About 2 months later, Orlando says, "I'm going to follow Jesus." And then his girlfriend, Adriana, she said, "I'm going to follow Jesus." They're married. Honey and Juscelia, they've been living together for years. They decide to get married, and they decide to be baptized the same week. Their niece, Stella, she's been living with a guy for 11 years. She goes back to her house and says, "We need to get married. I need to do the right thing." He said, "I'm not getting married." She said, "Goodbye, I'm following Jesus." And she's following Jesus till today. She brought her co-worker about 6 months ago, and I began teaching him, and he was baptized in June. Now that guy that she walked away from after 11 years, he got a little uptight. He wrote me an email and said, I want to talk to you. I said, I'm coming over. I thought he's going to beat the tar out of me. But when I got there, he's really a nice guy. And we've been studying the scriptures for the past 4 months. We'll study for 4 or 5 hours every Sunday night. And he's that close to making a decision. We need to pray for Sebastian. This is a marathon runner, mountain climber, fixes her own roof, Luciana, works at an automotive plant. One of our brothers brought her to our small group. My wife befriended her along with another sister, Zanir. They taught her and she was baptized into Christ. Now you may think, well, Alan, are you the only guy doing some work down there? No, we've had 75 baptisms in the last 2.5 years. Our elders, our deacons, our evangelists, our small group leaders, our Bible class teachers, everybody is involved in sharing the good news about Jesus. Dreams really do come true. And not only that, God gave my wife her dreams. She got this great guy. God gave my wife her childhood dream of 3 children. Nathaniel is our oldest in the middle. He's 23 years old. He's a senior at Oklahoma Christian. He's a graphic design major. He speaks fluent Portuguese and English without an accent in either language. And he also, kazoo, speaks some Japanese, if you can believe that. Natalie, our daughter, she is 21 years old. She's also a senior at Oklahoma Christian. She's a family studies major. And she speaks fluent Portuguese and English without an accent. And she also speaks Spanish. And our daughter that's with us this evening, Nayani, she's 19 years old. She speaks fluent Portuguese and English without an accent. She holds her own in Spanish. She just graduated from high school last year, and she's going to begin a culinary school towards the end of the year, and I'm looking forward to being her guinea pig. God also gave my wife her dream home. This is where we live in Curitiba. It's a typical Brazilian home. They have bars on the front. They have bars on the window. It's sort of a first century tradition, isn't it? You know, like the Apostle Paul, they lock the good people up. May God grant your heart's desires and all of your dreams. What are Alan and Reed going to be doing in the future? Our small group's always going to be winning souls. We're going to be planting brand new congregations. We're going to be teaching in 3 preacher training schools. We're going to be doing coaching work to help other congregations arrive at elders and deacons. And we're so excited to see what God's going to do with our future dreams for His glory. And we want to thank you for being our partners in the gospel. You are a big part of everything that's happening in Curitiba right now. And we're so thankful for your generosity and your sacrifice. Dreamers, it's never too late to start dreaming. Workers, it's never too late to start hanging out with someone with a great dream. I want to challenge all of you tonight to imagine a great dream for your marriage, for your family, for this congregation, for your business. Write it down and start praying to God about it. Every prayer request is a dream just waiting to happen. God's dream, the greatest dream of all time, is to have an eternal family. And if you're not a member of that eternal family right now, God invites you to be born again, to come into His family. Jesus came because He loves us. Jesus came because we have sin and He's the only solution. Jesus came to die on a cross to pay for our sins. He was buried. And to prove that He can give eternal life, He raised up from the grave. And if you want to become into His family, He asks you to believe that He died for you, was buried and resurrected. He asks you to change your life. Turn away from the evil and start following Him. Make a declaration that He will be the Lord of your life forever. You will follow Him. Someone will bury you in a watery grave. God will resurrect you. And then start spending time with Him every day. Have a deep relationship with Him. Sing to Him every day. Let His scriptures breathe in you. And praise His name. If you're here tonight and want to become a Christian, I invite you to make that decision now. Don't put it off. Maybe you have a special need, a challenge you're facing. You want one of the elders to pray for you. Let's do that tonight. Let's stand and sing, and if we can help you in any way.